successful.
It's got the strong guys that are very sudden, and more sudden than your transition are like that. In some areas, it's a long protracted come down or something. The transition is so gradual, you don't really get the notice, or it's more challenging to notice the transition, your transition itself. It's like the difference between waking up suddenly and slowly drifting out of sleep. When you wake up suddenly, like say an alarm goes off and you've been in a deep sleep, it's like the suddenness of the transition somehow makes it more obvious. The aspects of it as well. Mm-hmm. You know, suddenness and surprise are really good tricks and tools to use. There's a Dzogchen technique, which is very, very, very easy. It's also potentially useful. Someone yells, or you yell, suddenly and very staccato. You make that yell very loud, very suddenly, and in the aftermath, there's a moment of clarity. It's like physiological or something. It's mechanical. Even if you know it's coming, mechanically it occurs, and it's very interesting to see because again, there's this instant of openness, and then almost instantly it sort of recrystallizes, it almost recrystallizes. And because of the suddenness, you study it. It's very clear that this happens, both the openness and then the recrystallization. So you can notice a lot of the aspects of that, of what's up with all that, just by that. You can do it over and over.
Yeah.
There's several Dzogchen treatises which are just devoted to just that one very simple practice. Because it's mechanistic and it's completely effective and it's easy.
Yeah, I've done it before. It doesn't work.
Let's do it.
Bail
kit.
Yeah, shall we do it?
Yeah, let's do it.
Get out the Zen stick.
Can you yell loud enough?
I don't know. I'll try. Hey. Unaccustomed as I am to public yelling. Hey! Yeah, that's better. You're better. You do it. Oh, no, just one.
Do it.
Watch what happens. It's like a dip. You know, suddenly that goes this up.
There's a stillness in the room.
Well, it's not obviously a new stillness, but because the focus has been forcibly shifted back and forth, is the tendency for it not to be locked into a normalcy, so it's sort of more free-flowing.
Is it also the surprise that you feel when, for instance, a resonant sound, like a bell,
it
goes, and then you expect it to end, but it just keeps on going.
And, I mean, this is just taking advantage of a particular instance of perception, because the suddenness and the extremity of it, in this case, provokes a sudden change, which then changes back, and so you get to see the transition more readily. These kinds of transitions are always occurring, but typically we don't notice them because they're not so clearly demarcated. And the mind is spinning a narrative which glosses over it and bulldozes through it, and sort of enforces a kind of a continuity of the storyline of what's happening, as opposed to ignoring these actual little fluctuations and openings which are always occurring.
Earlier when you were speaking about labeling given that most of us are given to doing that, I was recently reading that this is kind of inherited, as in we are fear-based in our evolution. And so it became important to us to distinguish tiger hiding behind dry blades of grass. So pattern making was very essential to our survival.
Mm-hmm.
And so everything that we saw, we needed to filter down, categorize as a threat or a non-threat.
Mm-hmm.
And so that fundamental sense of fear, what I feel even as I meditate, and then it's like when the subconscious substance seems to kind of be drawn in me, it's like I somehow cannot allow for the drawing to happen. It's almost like I need to stay on top of that.
Mm-hmm.
So what could be the insight that helps me tell myself it's all right? It's kind of like the Native Indians apparently tell their children when they fall in a dream to allow themselves to fall and see what happens.
Mm.
So in that way, even as you're consciously aware, what is the insight that would help you break this need to be on top of things?
Yeah. Well, the need to be on top of things, or the fearfulness of vulnerability, is all based on the conception of yourself as existing independently in your body, usually, and that it's vulnerable, and so there's a need to protect it and defend it. And this, of course, shows up in fear of death or avoiding dangerous situations, and it can show up as a projection in more ways, like you're talking about, where drowning in more subconscious experience and such. But the what I recommend, which is basically a spin-off of what we've been talking about all day, is you notice that in actual fact you're not a separate. There's no separation that's findable, and so your body and your personality and your identity as a human being is an outgrowth of the fundamental substratum of being and is included in that. It's not actually separate and autonomous. And by finding that directly in your experience, then that diminishes this sense of protectedness and the urgency to the sense of vulnerability that one has when one identifies as this body-mind that is very vulnerable and independent, and it's the only thing you have, so you have to be constantly vigilant on guard of all threats and all this sort of thing. Because the individuality is an outgrowth, like we were talking with you, I don't remember, how the individuality is an outgrowth of all of the biosphere of life. Like so you're like the hair on the head of the earth, and your hair exists because you exist, and likewise, you exist as an individual because all of the system of life exists. This is talking about it in very particular terms, but more fundamentally, you exist because being exists, the most fundamental being, the most fundamental isness, the being of this world, of this actuality, is the being that makes you and is you, and there's no demarcation, there's no break where the being, the objective being is here and then you're up here as some separate thing that's vulnerable. So even if you were damaged, when your body, say your body dies or your body, you're very sick, whatever, that doesn't damage the fundamental being, which you are. It's like if you lost your hand, you wouldn't have lost yourself. You wouldn't have the hand anymore, but you would still be here.
But then if the damage did happen, what is the seeing without the body?
It's the fundamental condition. It's the condition that's always here. Seeing is not dependent upon the body.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing is how the body appears. The body comes from seeing, not the other way around.
Well, that is the literature, but how do I see that in the moment?
Well, again, by if you explore your experience very, very nakedly, you'll notice that the experience itself is inclusive. It's a continuum. And specifics arise out of the whole. So, you know, you see this picture here. The apparition of this picture arises out of the sea of your consciousness. And that is there, and then the experience of the picture arises, and then you leave or you close your eyes and the experience is gone, but the sea hasn't gone anywhere. And likewise, your body appears very much like this picture appears. You go to sleep and your body disappears, but the sea is still there. And we're often not aware of the sea. I'm talking in terms of this analogy. We're not aware of the sea. We're not aware of the background continuum because we attend more to the details and the specifics of our situation. But in actuality, all the details exist within the background and arise from the background and disappear back into the background, and the background doesn't come or go. And even the body is an apparition that appears in experience from the background of consciousness, or whatever you want to call it.
So, again, this is an analogy, right? So, what is it that, how do I see this in the moment that it's no longer a concept?
Oh, right, I see what you mean.
Or
okay.
Analogy.
Yeah. Watch how. Watch the arisings that occur. So, you can, like, for example, you can watch thoughts come and go. Thoughts come, you know, come and go, whatever. And where do they come out of? Where do they go to? You know, like bubbles that come up and pop. But what's the background is actually there as an experience. It's not a concept.
I see sensations there. So basically,
yeah.
These sensations, they form images, they form words,
yes.
And then they go back to
the sensations. But where do sensations come from? Before there's even sensations, where do they come from? Sensations also appear out of a deeper background, experientially. Let's say, have you ever had general anesthesia, surgery or something?
Yeah, I'm not gentle.
But where you were put out completely?
No.
Yeah, that's a shame. That's a wonderful experience.
It is.
I mean, not the surgery.
No, I know. I know what you're talking about.
But well, I'll talk about this from my perspective. Even if you haven't experienced it, you may find something in your experience that's similar. In general anesthesia, it's wonderful because, you know, they give you whatever they're doing. Everything fades away, but everything, your entire world disappears, your body disappears, I mean utterly, and it's deeper than being asleep, but it's not nothing. It's like this bedrock of fullness and richness. It's just, you know, there's no space, there's no time, there's no event per se, but it's just this fullness. And then when you start to wake up, the details slowly appear within the fullness, out of the fullness, but the fullness, it's not like the fullness disappears and then the details are here. The fullness, the background fullness, which is it's subtle, you know, then the details which are from the foreground are less subtle, they're more obvious, more gross, and then the attention goes to those and forgets the background, because the background is so subtle and it's relatively a non-event. But it's actually there experientially. I mean,
would it be kind of like when you're extremely sick? I mean, like, sometimes I get the flu so bad that I just lie down and my mind is too tired to think. But in that absence of thought, there is an intensification of awareness. And that's the closest that I can pin.
No, it's more fundamental than that. How about this? When you say you're feeling good, you know, and there's your awareness and there's your experience. Say you're not feeling good, or say you drink too much, or you're very sick, you have a high fever, and everything is very blurry. But you see that blurriness with absolute clarity. The seeing, the clarity of seeing doesn't get blurry, ever, even as what's appearing is blurry. So the appearing always appears in the clarity, and the clarity is not dependent upon what's appearing superficially.
So in the early hours of the morning, if I get up sometimes and I feel really foggy, I can't seem to do a thing right.
Mm-hmm.
So that awareness is still clear.
Yeah.
Of this fogginess.
Yeah, or you wouldn't know it was foggy. You know it's foggy because you're clearly seeing the fogginess.
Right. But again, I don't know that awareness, that seeing this fogginess, are just two separate parts of this body. How do I know that that which sees is not of the body?
Because it's not affected by bodily process. In other words, like I said, if you get very sick, the clarity doesn't get sick, doesn't get diseased, it doesn't diminish. If you get very intoxicated, the clarity doesn't get intoxicated. It's like a perfectly clear pane of glass, and everything appears in the glass, but the glass doesn't change. And that's always there. If it was dependent on the body, then if the condition of the body changed, it would change too.
But I also have this narrative that, like I was saying earlier, when I feel extremely sick and the mind shuts down,
mm-hmm.
there's this intense awareness of the condition of all of this.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is this thing saying that, okay, one part of my body shuts down and then another awakens. So so this is the thing, right? For me, I can't really tell whether this is an idea
right.
or this is a fact.
Right. Well, anything that changes or comes and goes is not the bedrock. So if you have an awareness that intensifies, that's not the fundamental awareness. That's just another thing appearing. Like say you drink some coffee and you're very alert and very aware. Or say you're very tired and you know and you have to stay up and you're blurry. So that those things that change are just more their appearances that appear within the fundamental clarity. The clarity does not change one iota. It's absolutely constant in its nature.
If you were forced to give a few key words that characterize, like, I know you can't talk about it, but to the extent that you can, what can you say about that fundamental? What's the nature of that fundamental?
Isness. Right now, this is. Now look at that, a presence. I we need a presence, this is what I'm talking about, the presence. Right now, your experience is present. Look very closely at how do you know it's present? What do you mean by present? It's completely self-evident that it's present, right? It couldn't be more present or less present, it's just present, right? It just is. So, but look, what is that? I mean, just look at it. There is this presence, it's right here, right? This is present, this exists, it is. What is that? What do you mean by that? And I don't mean the concept, you know? Intuitively, it's a felt obviousness that this is present, this is. So, look at it, check it out. What is this? Isness?
I guess we're
it's not here. Nothing, it's very, very actual. We don't attend to it usually, we take it for granted because it's the context within which everything that we attend to occurs.
We usually, when we think of isness, we think of sights and sounds. We associate it with objects or something.
Oh, well, yeah, typically, you know, this room is. But when I say this room is, okay, here's the room. What do I mean by it is? How do I know it is? You know, prove it to myself that this room is. Well, in one sense, that's absurd. It's self-evident. Okay, cool. What is this self-evidence? It's not an abstraction. It's very, very concrete. It's a subtle concreteness. It's not a concreteness that it's not like the kind of concreteness that we usually fixate on with our attention to details, because it's a global concreteness. But, you know, isness, presence, now. Now is another word for the same thing. This is now, right? Undeniably, this is now. What is that? What is this now? Again, it's not, it sounds like an abstraction, but if you look, it's not an abstraction, it's a felt sense. That this is, and that this is now, is completely self-evident. So what is that? It's something, it's not nothing, it's an actuality. And it's not a class of object like we usually deal with or orient towards. It's a whole, it's a different order of, category. So that's some kinds of indication. And this presence is radiant. It never shows up naked, it never shows up plain or clear. It always shows up with all sorts of information seemingly present. Always. You go into deep sleep and there's still all sorts of information present. You start dreaming, there's still information. You have general anesthesia and you're practically out, there's still information present. Very subtle information, but it's not nothing. Always that radiance, that bubbling up of experiential qualities.
But for lack of sensitivity to these subtle things, that's why it seems that experience depends on a body, as opposed to the other way around.
I wouldn't say it's lack of sensitivity. I'd say it's a long history of distraction and orienting. You know, when you were a toddler, when you were an infant, you had a long, protracted, we can imagine you had a long, protracted period of discovering this thing and learning to inhabit it and so on and so forth, seemingly. And this is very strongly and heavy-handedly reinforced by the behavior of your parents and so on and so forth, and then strongly and heavy-handedly reinforced by, as you learn words and language and the structure of language and the implication of words reinforces it all the more. You know, you're you, this is mama, this is daddy, you're you. You know, and when you're you, I point to your body. you know, and so there's a heavy-handed brainwashing of orientation. And there's basically no evidence presented to a contrary perspective of, well, if this is my body, what is the body in? If this is the body, what is not the body? And what's the relationship between the two? That's not a question that's ever asked. Mm-hmm. Not the body is other, it's that, it's over there, it's not me. But this is me, this is the body, this is me. But we don't ever look very closely at the actual interrelationship or the actual demarcation or the actual boundary. And if you do, experientially, you don't find one. You know, it turns out that the experiential presence of, I see your face and I see my hand, and there's no me-ness or you-ness present in my field of vision, and so on and so forth. But we don't bother with that kind of exploration because we're busy playing the game that we've been so heavy-handedly trained in.
It's like this way we have we're so used to interpreting the experience like this is my hand. Yeah. It's, although when you stand back, there is no difference. It's just a different. It is just a different texture. It's not more so than me looking at the painting on the wall or hearing the voice.
But we're not used to thinking of it in terms of variety of texture. We're used to thinking of it as separate, discrete entities that autonomously exist.
Right.
You're you over there, I'm me here. That painting's that over there. All of a sudden we imagine all these separate, you know, discrete separate entities that are basically disconnected from each other. But experientially that's not the case. Experience is a continuum. You know, overall, it's It's a matter of looking at experience freshly and nakedly and noticing the way it does not conform to our maps of it, to our ideas of it, to all these ways we've been brainwashed and trained to see it. It's possible and it's viable to see it in those terms. I can see this is my body and this is not me and so on. But that's an artificial imposition on an experiential actuality which is inclusive. And simply seeing that, noticing that, takes you out of your normalcy. And then you're off and running.
It's a very strong memory that wants to. Because I so resonate with that picture of him, the toddler, before the concepts and before the this is me and that. I so get that.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently this memory, that, you know, you're not even thinking about this when we're often, quote unquote, so-called day-to-day life.
But it's not a memory. You're still the toddler that you were. All the sophistication is just layers that have been piled
yes,
on top of that.
Yes,
you're still you through this you that is wandering around. You don't. All you are is basically here I am. On that level, that's all you know. That's all you can really assert or say or feel. You know, that's what a newborn baby feels. It's like I am. Here I am. You know, and all this, but that doesn't go anywhere.
Right.
That's still there. And then
all
the sophisticated and training and education and you know conditioning is layered on top of that, but the raw thing is still there. You're still that you that you were when you were a month old.
So my concern is these layers and the memories and
yeah, but they're not a problem. Just go back and see that layer that fundamental layer which is always still already there. And then you don't need to solve these other things because they're irrelevant. They're not true anyway.
That's really interesting, Peter, because I even found the most gorgeous picture of a toddler in the grass, just in absolute joy, just like I remember seeing you illustrate that the very first time. And yet, I don't know, that just seems to get forgotten or something like that. And
yeah. But just because it's not attended to doesn't mean it's not there. And it's possible to notice it and attend to it. Well, I mean, look for yourself. Just feel what it felt like when you were in your room when you were 6 months old and you were just looking around. What did it feel like? And then just look around this room as if how you would have looked back then. Just look and this is all this. You don't know what anything is. There's just this aliveness and this drifting association. Very non-specific. Because those modes are they don't need to be remembered because they're still present. Even again, if we don't give them much attention.
Peter, could you say that you're still the same you that you were before you were born?
Oh, absolutely. But, you know, that's a little bit of a leap for a lot of people, so if you can get back to 6 months, that's a good start. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's really getting to the heart of the matter.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Maybe a little more, you know, like you said, it's a little more complicated, a little harder to remember.
Yeah. But that's there too.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's there, it really is.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's, you know, the cellular memory or what have you, however you want to try and qualify it.
Yeah.
Do you remember the face of your grandparents or something before
yeah.
they were born?
Well, yeah, but it's not a matter of the literalness or the details. It's a matter of the, you are your grandparents. You know, your grandparents. Genetic cells met and became your parents, whose genetic cells met and became you. And there is no point where that is broken. You know, it's like you look at the bubbling brook in the mountains, and you look at the Mississippi River entering the Gulf of Mexico, and it's a continuum. That is the Mississippi. It's not. It doesn't stop. It doesn't. It's not a brook here, and then it stops being a brook, and there's some kind of break, and then it becomes a river. So you are your roots, and it goes back forever. You know, I'm looking at it sort of in terms of history of time, or you can look at it just in terms of inclusiveness with the system. So the entirety of the being of the universe, all everything is acros and of that, that don't depart from that, and the details of that is acros of that, and then you have the solar system, which is an acros of the being of the universe. You have the biosphere on Earth, which is an acros of the being of the universe, and we have you. So you are an acros of the being of the entire universe. And there's no break in the chain. There's no point where it's the universe here and it's you there, and they're not joined. So you are the universe. I mean, in the most literal physical sense. You know, and the consciousness that sees through your eyes is the fundamental being of the universe. Consciousness is like the you know, you've heard of the unified field theory. Consciousness is a unified field, and all the various physics, all the various aspects of the four forces of physics and so on are aspects of that. So consciousness is not some byproduct of certain organization of cells and electricity and chemistry in the brain, where consciousness arises as a byproduct. Consciousness is the root condition, and matter is an outgrowth of that, and higher organization of life forms is an outgrowth of that, and here you are. And again, it's all a continuum, inclusive. So you are the full sea of consciousness, universal consciousness. Not theoretically, but concretely, right here, right now.
That suggests that science's effort to discover the fundamental building blocks of life is a futile exercise unless they recognize that consciousness is primary.
Well, even then it's going to be futile, because science is predicated on resolvability. And every actuality, all of the fundamental field and all of its, and even all of its offshoots, are all unresolvable. And so science peels the onion layer by layer and pushes back every attempt to think they're getting closer to the resolution. But it's never going to happen, because there is no resolution. There's just layers and layers and layers. You know, now we're at quarks or whatever, but that's just the current layer.
Well, isn't that all a, it's like a fabrication. My grandparents and all these things, all of that stuff is occurring right here.
Yes.
Yeah,
right,
that's what I'm saying.
And this is all there is.
Yeah.
That's it.
You are, if you want to see your grandparents, look right there. That's what this is what your grandparents look like right now.
Whether or not they're alive right now. That's your.
Well, they are alive.
Yeah.
They are alive as
this. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
But whether or not they're alive is an apparent individual body.
Yeah. Like, for example, I have kids. I'm alive. My kids are alive, but my kids are me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, they are. They really are me.
Your kids are this.
And they're this, because I am this. And
right
they
here.
Are, yeah. Yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
It's like watching a flower bud in slow motion. I mean, time lapse. So at first it's just a little green stick, and then all these things just keep coming out of itself until this beautiful flower opens. So we're the flower at the end of it. We're kind of like, we're the part that's...
And you run it backwards, and before there's even a bud, that's what the flower looks like.
And it just keeps going back and back to...
You know, when you run it backwards far enough till there's just a little sapling coming out of the earth, and that's what the flower looks like then.
Yeah.
There.
Right. And it goes back into
it's
the other
like
flower.
It's a sapling, and then it becomes a bush, and then it becomes a bud, and then it becomes a flower.
That's continuing.
The sapling is the flower at that point in its unfolding. It's an inclusive continuum. And not just historically or spatially, You are everything.
In this moment.
Literally.
Right? Just
well, this is, yeah, but there's no moment, so this moment is everything. So you are everything. You're saying it's in this moment doesn't qualify anything. It's in this moment is a given. The totality of reality is in this moment, always. And, you know, this stuff is, this is not abstractions. I'm not talking about abstractions. This is supremely concrete.
If I may, the second statement, he says, since there is nothing that goes beyond just this, that's it.
Yeah.
It's just this is the totality.
That's it.
And
period.
From here, perhaps it can go just deep into the experience of feeling of genes, or we get into a car and drive to the ends of the earth, but it's still this. There's nothing outside of this.
Yeah. There's infinite apparent unfoldments, but they aren't actual unfoldments because they're all unfoldments of this within this. Nothing is developed or added to.
So my grandma and grandpa and all that historical stuff, and but it's...
Yeah, sure, of course.
Intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
Intimacy.
Yeah, there is nothing but pure intimacy. It is beyond intimacy because intimacy still implies a separation that's being bridged, and there's no separation to bridge. It's all bridge and no separation. All bridging without anything to be bridged. It bridges itself.
The bridge to nowhere.
What's that? Oh, the bridge to nowhere. Yeah. Yeah, this the title of Deepak Chopra's latest book is just like you said, "You Are the Universe." That's actually the title, and so it must be true.
Deepak says that it must be true, and even Lonely Me is saying it. Out here in the trenches, they're saying it too.
It's true now.
Just if I am the universe, I gotta figure out what to do.
Well, fortunately, that's not actually the way it works.
You won't need to worry about that.
I don't know if this is a right expression, but it's like the propriety of all this is that it's not even remotely an intellectual understanding. Right?
No.
It's just self-evident. It's just
intellect can't possibly approach this.
Yeah. I find that the more I try to approach it or try to nail it down, it's like it's steering away.
Yeah. Without actually getting away from it, of course, but yeah.
This is like the edge of that thing over there. I keep wanting to go over and touch it and see if it's actually sticking out. And haven't looked at it closely. That's what this seems like to me. Is that really something, a fold?
Sorry, God, it's so close, there's not even room for a way.
Thank you.
if you see that you're the universe, where does desire come in? Would the desire for something to be different even arise?
Desire is an aspect of the universe. Desire, the universe is dynamic, and desire is a word for that dynamism. Desire as being a desire, you know, from something to for something is an oversimplification, but the actual condition of desire is simply a dynamism.
Well, there's a certain kind of a, I don't know, maybe a, like maybe the usual, call it stressed out condition. You know, yeah, I wish I had this, or I wish I had this, or I wish it was someplace else. Mm-hmm. But there seemed like there would be no room for that if you just realize it's all this. And this is,
well, there's a room for that, but it isn't being called that. And when you're relating to things in terms of interpretive framework, you're defining a condition as being a certain way, and then you're supposed to, you're defining maybe that condition lacks something or could be improved in some way, and then you're defining what would be the improvement, and you're strategizing ways to get that, to add it to it in the hopes of improving it or whatever. But all that exists as interpretation. And yet, even without interpretation, hunger may appear, and then getting up and going to or needing to pee, going up and looking for a bathroom. It's not out of a desire to get something or improve something. It's just a vector of activity that appears spontaneously because this is intrinsically dynamic, intrinsically active, you could say.
One of the things I talked to you when you were saying experiential sensitivity, I was reading this book, Hunter put up about what you've been saying. One saying that this experience, I think you were laying the emphasis on the experiencing the field instead of the objects.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I see that blueness of the painting, I experience the blueness,
mm-hmm.
but then the blueness is a part of something, and then the experience is a part of the whole,
mm-hmm.
right? And then does that experiential sensitivity stop there, or does it go to see what is it that is experiencing the whole as well?
Yes, absolutely. It goes on forever, which ultimately means returning to itself. Because what is experiencing the whole is the whole. You know, the object and the subject are one and the same. That is reality. So what's doing the experiencing is actuality. What's being experienced is actuality. So actuality is experiencing itself. But you can say God is exploring itself. And that's what our experience actually is. We think that we're looking at our lives, but it's actually God looking at God. and it seems to form the configurations of all these complexities that we define as myself and my life and the circumstances, but that's all defined into existence out of the fundamental apparition. I mean, you know, this is another very interesting and very obvious sort of an exploration, although it's ultimately very quixotic too, is look at what is seeing your experience. Right now, here's your experience. Something is seeing your experience. Like what's seeing the light that's appearing in your experience? What's seeing it? You know? Very interesting. It's clearly manifestly being seen. But what's doing it? From where? How? You know, it cannot be found. Even though it's completely self-evident that it is that way.
That seems a lot closer, looking at that, it seems a lot closer to what you were describing as like, well, the experience of going under general anesthetic,
mm-hmm.
or deep sleep.
Well, they're kind of one and the same.
Yeah, it's that,
it's that thing of you know it's there, you know you were asleep, because you said I was asleep, you knew you were asleep, but there's nothing to say about it.
It doesn't resolve.
Yeah.
The unresolvability is very clearly evident if you're looking for what's seeing your experience, because it's manifestly concrete, it's manifestly actual, and you don't find anything.
Yeah.
It doesn't resolve into being something that you can say, oh, yeah, there it is, I see it, it's right there, you know? At the objective pole, we find the same condition, although it's a little more complicated, because at the objective pole of what we seem to be experiencing, there seems to be all of this incredible diversity of characteristics and all that. But again, if you go try and pin down what any of them actually are, it doesn't resolve into any kind of coherence. It doesn't resolve into any kind of findable, you know, coherent nature. Everything consists of something else. Everything consists of and includes aspects which split off, which diversify from what it superficially seems to be. And those diversifications split off also into further diversifications. And so you just, you know, it all splits off from itself. It doesn't converge into a coherence or a simple wholeness. It diverges into a cloud of you know, you can't say what. So you don't actually find, you start, whatever you start looking for, you don't actually find it.
Yeah.
You know, it can be difficult to see the way that's, because we're so used to looking at things and pretending to be able to resolve them, you know, and so we have a heavy-handed ability to orient to the imagination's resolution that we're used to imposing on things. But if you look closely at your experience, you discover it's not actually like that.
When you ask that question, like, right now, what is seeing or feeling your experience? So that's no different from all the seeming stuff that's out there. There's no real... There's no line, there's no difference.
No, there's no direction. You can't find it. Yeah. You can say, well, that's another sort of an aspect of the same thing. Well, here's this that's seeing my experience, whatever, even though I can't find it, here it is. And here's what's being seen. Where's the demarcation? Where's the break? Where does the subject stop and the object begin? And you don't find anything like that. It's a continuum, it's inclusive.
What would the demarcation be that this I can actually see and feel, but that which is seeing it, I can't find it.
Mm-hmm.
That which is seeing all this is unfindable. But this seems to be so.
But you feel it in the way that you do. It may be a subtle kind of a feeling.
Yeah, that's that thing that we just have these preferences about the textures that we sense, it seems like. So this seems more solid than whatever that amorphous thing is that is seen by experience.
Yeah,
but
experience is a lot like an iceberg where only a very small percentage of it is actually resolvable or seemingly resolvable, and most of it is just this amorphous noise. And our the mode of our consciousness is takes advantage of this fact by censorship. So all the fuzzy stuff we ignore. So right at this moment, you know, you're thinking all sorts of weird vibes and nuance and little flavors, and they're flitting in and out, and you might not even notice it because it doesn't amount to anything. It's just sort of noise in the system. It's like sort of background fuzz. And you know, well, but I'm seeing what I'm seeing, and I'm thinking about what I'm thinking about. But if you look at your thoughts, there's actually all this other stuff, this other noise in the system that isn't really falling in line with the particular concrete train of thought that's showing up as a train of thought. And all of that is engineered by censorship, by ignoring the things that don't make, the aspects of experience, experiential characteristics or qualities that don't make sense, that don't resolve into any coherence, obviously. And so that's all just written off. So by a kind of a pseudo-hypnotic mechanism, it's just, somehow it's just denied, it's just not even seen. You know, you have a fever or something like that, you do the experiment where you look at the wall, and you notice all this amazing dynamism and twinkles and sparkles and weird vibes and weird stuff is continually flickering in experience. But the consciousness is really expert at just shutting that stuff down. It's not even happening.
So does one get a sense of permanency? Get sort of a sense of solidity without all the byproducts of what you think of the solid. It's like,
yeah, of course. Because you see that what is here is fundamentally invulnerable. It's fundamentally does not change. It's not dependent upon any apparent changes in conditions that may seem to appear do not affect it. It's not dependent upon that. It's independent. Everything is dependent on it. And this becomes, this is very clear and obvious, and it's felt, it's self-verifyingly reveals itself like that. And again, this becomes more and more obvious, and when develops more and more of a feeling of confidence. So,
how would you describe it more?
Which?
This.
Well, it's indescribable. So.
Yeah.
There's actuality. I mean, radiant presence says it all for me. And again, that may sound like an abstraction, but to me, it's extremely common. This presence and then all of this apparition. This, not generally, but this specific apparition right here, right now. Mm-hmm. It's always this apparition right here, right now, and it's always present. And the presence does not fluctuate, it doesn't come and go. Now is never more or less present. The characteristics that can seem to be present can be very fuzzy and very amorphous, but they're always fuzzy and amorphous exactly now and exactly in this presence.
The key thing that I heard you say then is that underlying whatever the apparent content or the apparent apparitions are is that eternal presence.
Yes, although it's not actually underlying. I mean, it may seem to be underlying.
Yeah.
It seems to be underlying because we're not used to attending to it. Mm-hmm. And so it can seem like a background, but you can actually look at it as a foreground.
Yeah.
just as truly.
Yeah.
I mean, ultimately, it's one and the same. The changeless background of presence and all of these amazing fluctuations of apparition are actually one and the same. Talking about it, it seems like there's a polarity there, but it's not actually like that.
And that comes as a default way of experiencing.
Well, it is actually the default way of experiencing. So when you notice that, then obviously you recognize that, because it's
mm-hmm.
manifestly the case.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only way you've ever experienced. You can't experience any other way.
But you can be deceived by the noise that you bring.
You can be confused by trying to follow your fantasies about it, your misinterpretations.
Mm-hmm. That experience that was just talked about, the difference between when you look and it's, you can't really grasp it, and you put your hand on your leg. something solid is here. I think that's just an immediate, unexamined assumption. Because if you do it, I just did it, and you just allow the attention to go to there, it all of a sudden, it can't be found. There's no place where this ends and this begins.
That's right.
It's just, it's as diffuse as anything else.
Yeah, that's all there is.
Yeah.
All there is diffusion, endless and infinite diffusion. What we call the flow of time is the diffusion of present conditions, and then the future conditions seem to be something, and then they're instantaneously diffusing, so this ongoing diffusing and disappearing.
Almost like a smoke screen. All this stuff is here, so it's designed by no one or something to take us out of what's actually right in front of us.
But it doesn't take you, it can seem to take you out.
Yeah.
But it doesn't actually, because it only takes you out if you think there's an out and you think there's an it and so on and so forth. Which is obviously possible to do, but not actually doesn't stand up to scrutiny. You know, the bottom line is this is what infinity happens to look like. Infinity looks at itself, and this is what it sees. Now, who's to say what infinity is supposed to look like?
What is infinity supposed to look like?
Yeah, who's to say what infinity is supposed to look like? This right here is exactly what infinity looks like. When infinity looks at itself, this is what it sees. Go figure.
I was fascinated by the way this stuff plays out, because you may very well right now have a real sense of the fact that 3 o'clock is rapidly approaching and you're going to get up and go.
Mm-hmm.
Right in the midst of recognizing the clear seeing that there's no time, that the time
sure.
is ever present. Reality.
Yeah, because time and timelessness are not contraries.
Yeah.
Yeah, time is a way of seeing timelessness.
Mm-hmm.
So when speaking of time, a certain teacher, Krishnamurti, for instance, he used to draw this distinction between functional time, 3 o'clock flight, versus psychological time, I will be better tomorrow. This thing about physical time seems like you're giving into the universe when the clock strikes three. There's a call for action from the outside, but this other thing seems to be like you need to drive it. You need to drive it. At 4 o'clock, maybe your flight leaves with or without you, so that's automatically taken care of. But because I need to drive, I kind of am constantly maintaining two states, the better me versus the not so well-to-do, and I always keep projecting back and forth to see how I'm doing, measuring my steps all the way. So when you say there is no time, do you mean it as in the even the functional sense of time is absent, or the psychological sense of time is absent?
Well, both those two ways you're qualifying it are what the condition of no time can be seen in. It's always now. There's never not now. Now seems to change, but change can't be pinned down or found. So there's just always now. You know, the hands of the clock seem to move. It seems to get brighter outside and then dark outside. But what any of that is not resolvable. And it's always exactly right now. So the moving of the hands, the reading on the internet that, you know, the flight leaves at 5 o'clock, and the concept that it takes an hour to get to the airport, all of these things occur now and consist of what they actually consist of, which is this that exists now. And they look, they may seem to be all these various discrete coexisting engagements, let's call it, but that's just a way of putting it. That because this can seem any way that it can, and it can seem like all sorts of coexistence of various different modes and engagements simultaneously occurring. But it's always just exactly itself, because anything that appears has to be this itself. So if there is thought, if there is expectation, if there is planning, that has to be this itself that we're calling that, or that we're seeing as if it was that. You know, it's like the habit of thinking that a logical, analytical mind is different than direct perception is an abstraction. Logical, analytical mind, if it exists, is present, so it is itself a direct perception. and so on and so forth. So anything that can seem to exist is this. And what it seems to be, or what it's being described to be, is itself an abstraction of something that is inclusively and seamlessly this that is here. So this is no time, this is planning, this is scheduling, this is expectation, this is abstraction. But it's not actually any of those things. It's just it can be seen as being that, seen in those terms, but that doesn't mean it actually becomes that.
So, Peter, could you say that in view of that, there's in reality, there's no significance to what we perceive having happened in the past?
There's no significance to what we think of what we perceive having happened in the past.
Right.
Yeah. There's no significance to our narrations or our interpretations.
Would it also be accurate to say nothing ever happened?
Yes. Yeah, we touched on that last night and this morning, in fact.
Okay.
So, yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Because you know, it's not necessarily a simple nothing, not a negation or a cancellation, but of course there's nothing to negate or cancel, so that's a moot point. But you can't find, you know, all we define our descriptions of events and conditions and so on into existence in the context of this actuality. But those definitions cannot be found as an actuality. So the only actuality is this, and is this an anything? Is it happening? Even happening is an abstraction. What does that mean? Is anything happening? You know, you go to sleep at night and you dream, and you wake up. Did anything happen? There was nothing there. How could it have happened? It was a dream.
Yeah.
You know. So I mean, the whole question is not that it's a simple nothing or negation or canceled out, but it certainly eludes. That kind of a simplistic description.
So how do you get past the reality that memory is creating constantly? Like, I know clearly, for instance, when I wake up from a dream, yes, nothing happened. But my project deadline draws nearer,
mm-hmm.
the memory of having seen that on the project chart, all that.
Mm-hmm.
So that seems to be generating its reality very strongly.
Sure.
So how do I see that in the same way that I see a dream?
Because it is the same. It's just an apparition that's occurring as that. Suppose you're dreaming about seeing your project on the list, and you're dreaming about, oh, I have to do that, and you're dreaming about planning to do it and setting aside time or whatever. What's the difference? It appears, and it's viable to interpret it like that, and so that's just an actuality. This appears, and it's viable to interpret it in all different sorts of ways, and we do these interpretations. But just because we interpret something a certain way doesn't make it that. It is what it is, regardless of how we interpret it. And the fact that it appears means it's actual, but it's almost certainly not whatever you think it is, simply because actuality is too slippery and non-linear, irrational, to be interpreted simply.
So if I may, I want to just go back to that question of saying who is noticing.
Yeah.
So asking that question, I mean, there's a thought experiment that I think comes from the Upanishads where this character is being asked, okay, by what light do you see what is in front of you? And then he's saying, like, by the light of the sun. And at night, by what do you see? And says, like, by the light of the stars and the moon. And then when those have faded into darkness, by what light do you see? By the light of my mind. And then by the light of what do you see the contents of your mind? And then he stumbled into the innate awareness that sees everything.
Mm-hmm.
But even there, I did have a question as to what is it that draws the conclusion, okay, that is the awareness of the substratum of everything.
It is that awareness itself which draws that conclusion. And it doesn't draw it as a conclusion, it sees it as a fact. Because it's not a conclusion, it's not a result of logic, it's a result of self-verifying observation. So light is appearing in your experience right now, I assume. That's not a matter of logic or argument, it's a self-verifying fact. And likewise, what's seeing the light, and you can go through all these kinds of steps if you want, but ultimately, you get to the same self-verifying fact, regardless of what you call it and what words you use to describe it. Anyway, I'm very sorry I have to knock off and rush out real fast. So it's been lovely to be with you all today. I'm sorry I have to leave early.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Great day.
Can you look what can we do to help out? Chairs and people in there?
Can we actually go, can someone go back there on the left of that door?
Okay.
And the rest of the
okay. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. That's later. Where in the back? Up there somewhere.
Whether you do it or don't.
Well, I mean, this, I haven't.
I've noticed when I've watched a few of your presentations lately, and I was wondering how it was mic, because it's like it's kind of echo.
We started here.
Yeah, it's like that far away. If you got a mic on here, you would give you more presence. Thank you so much. See you soon. Down south, right? Happy trails. Thank you very much, Peter. You're very enjoyable. I've seen you a couple times before. It's been a while. Enjoyed this.
John, my brother.
Oh.
Yeah. So he lives down there. He lives in Burien, so he's on his way home. So works out good.
I'll be in touch with you.
Okay. Sounds good. Take it easy.
Yeah.